Right. There we go. Well, that was interesting. All right, so we got that's the beginning. Let me know if you can hear me and what's going on here, because I have oh, my computer is blowing up. All of a sudden we got like no signal. We got the camera switching. We got all kinds of things going on. Clearly, I have not live streamed in a while. Oh, now I'm kicking out huge amounts of megabits. I don't know what was going on, but I was getting 500 megabits or kilobits or whatever they are. So I was like, man, we got no signal. So let me see what we've got over here. Got the chat rocking it out. All right. Hey, guys. Wow. All right. Cool. Lots of guys here and girls. We got people from all over. 6:22 a.m. Hey. Well, that's early. Let me know how the sound is, guys. Okay, good. I got a new audio thingy. Hopefully we'll do some more live streaming coming into the new year. I was sitting down to do this edit and I was like, you know what? I haven't done live stream in a while, so we'll try to make this a more regular thing. So I had yeah, there we go. Well, make me small here. Did that work? No, it did not. Or did it? Yeah, it did. Okay. I literally had to pre-program my stream deck as well, because I don't know. It's been so long since we've done one of these that all my files have moved, so like nothing was working. But in any case, we're working now. Denmark. Nice. And I have sound. So I have sound and I have video, whether or not I guess that's all we really need, right? Okay, so you may know Raquel Lilly from the Adorama Twitch channel, or from other things, I guess. Musician here. We did actually a live stream with her for Adorama a while back, and she gave me a call. She had a friend, her and a friend were coming into town. Damien, he is from a group called Cannibal Kids and does some stuff on his own as well, I guess. Or maybe Cannibal Kids is goodbye. It was a little unclear, but she reached out to me and said, hey, we want to do some shots. You're around? And I was like, heck yeah. So here we are, right? We've got no sound or picture. Huh? Hold on, no sound or picture? Let me know now if you have sound and picture. You should be looking at could be that you're not caught up because I know that there was some issues. All right, good on this one. There was some delays. I had to keep starting and stopping it. So if you are not getting any sound or picture, then you probably can't hear me saying this. So I guess it's not worth me saying. But in any case, hopefully we can trim the first part of the video off. Anyways, the point being, Raquel Lilly came by with her friend Damien, and they actually had some fashion shots that they had shown me, some funky fashion shots. All I can see is like a little thing over my face. I move myself, huh? I can move myself over here. Makes more sense too that I'm not looking the wrong way. There we go. That's better, right? All right, good. Yeah, so they had some idea. This is kind of a fun shoot because, you know, a lot of times you just kind of go in there and you're messing around, which is also fun, but this is fun because they had an idea and I wanted to put my own spin on it. So we're going to edit these out and send them off to these guys so they can choose which ones they want. For their selection. But as we were shooting, and I often do this, I think I mention this a lot in videos, and then you know, we don't actually put it into use when I'm showing you guys the live streams, because I typically do it after the fact. But as we were going through these things, I had them pick ones on the spot that kind of grabbed them right away, right? That they were looking at and they were like, hey, you know, I like these. And they marked them. I always warn people that when you do that you may not like those exact same ones later, but it's a good idea to do it anyways. So basically, they did that. So we're looking at my Capture One screen here. I have not upgraded to 22 yet. I was about to do it, and then I was like, you know what? I'm going to do a live stream. I don't want to go in with a new setup. So by the new year, we'll have 22 on here. I already purchased it. I got my code. I just haven't updated it yet. So, any case, we've got the shots. She was getting ready still, so I did some quick test shots with him because they showed me some pretty flat lighting, and I wasn't sure if that's really what they wanted because sometimes people show you examples and that's not necessarily what they really want. But turns out they did want really flat lighting. So the first few shots, I'm kind of messing around the lighting to give them some idea of what could be done here. But before we get to that, like I said, I had them go through and pick ones that they liked, and they actually just starred them 5 stars to make it easy for us to find them. And we can see here that these are the ones that they basically liked, right? So these are the ones they liked so far. They're not tweaked or anything. They're just like, as they were looking quickly in the computer between shots, these are the shots that they liked. So unfortunately, I just, to make it simple for them, I just said, hey, mark it 5 stars. But if you've ever seen me edit something before, the very first thing I do is mark everything 3 stars and work from there, right? So what I'm going to do is, before I change it, I want to make sure I note these ones. So I'm going to go up here to my adjustments color tag, and I'm going to just color tag them all red. I'll tell you the orange. All right, so now they're orange. So now what will happen is when I go and I clear that search so that everything's showing, I'm going to select all my images. So just Command A, and then I'm going to make them all 3 stars. So I do this if you're new to this. I haven't done one of these in a while, so it might be a lot of new people here. Also, I'm terrible at checking the, I'll check the chat periodically. I select every image and I mark them 3 stars. And the reason why I do that is because I find it easier to edit by removing things than I do to look for the best one. So first I mark them all 3 stars, and then I go up here to my search, and I search for everything that is 3 stars or better. So that means that like this one here is a black frame, right? I don't want that. That was just checking the light. So I know I don't want that in the final search. So I'm just going to hit the number 2, and it disappears from my search. This way we're good to go. I'll just keep doing that until I eliminate them. Now the reason why I don't make them 1 star or 4 stars or some other thing is because if anything is like completely unusable, I'll mark it as 1 star. If there's something that is like super borderline, I want to look at it later, I'll make it two stars basically, right? So, whenever I go back to look at the ones I deleted, like in the end, if I'm like, oh, why did I delete some? I'll go back and I'll look at the 2-star ones, but that usually isn't the issue. That only happens if we end up with no good ones. All right, so what's going on in the chat? I wish I could make this bigger. My eyesight is not getting better as I get older. Oh, there we go. It's bigger now. All right, so I'm just going to start right here. I may have missed some at the beginning. I see somebody from LA calling. Slight echo. That might be because of the I got two big glass screens in front of me, so if I talk loud, you often get an echo. Like I think I just heard an echo there. More info about X, right? Okay. I don't have a passport, but that's something I can mark down as something to talk about. Let me screenshot that. I haven't got a passport with me. I have used them before. But I usually just use the big one, not the passport, because the passport, my understanding is, I'll have to check. But the last time I looked, it was really set to work with Lightroom, and I don't really use Lightroom. You never tell them, but you're looking to invest. I would definitely give it a shot. Capture One used to have a 30-day free trial. And obviously, you can also, course, use Lightroom and Tether. I prefer Capture One, but Lightroom certainly is a good option if you already have it. I know a lot of people have the Adobe Suite. Tethered, yes. Oh yes, thanks, Beth. Yeah, you all wanna drop a like? That's always sweet. Yeah, let's do this. Okay, so this is Damien. Like I said. I love these clothes. I am such a, yeah, I love funky clothes. So, I wanted to show him something with a little bit more contrast and shadow because that's typically what people like, to be honest with you. But he really did want flat shots. So in the end, we ended up going more flat, and you'll see that as we go. But let's start and we'll go through it. So at first, I'm just kind of sizing it up to see generally if what the outfit looked like with the gray background, because we were kind of up in the air about the gray background. They had initially wanted maybe something green, but the problem with that was that I didn't have a green textured background nor green paper that was not chroma key. And since, a lot of times if you're doing a fashion shoot, you'll have all the clothes and stuff ahead of time. They just told me green, and I was like, I'm not going to go buy a bunch of rolls of green paper. We probably wouldn't find one that would match anyways. If you are doing a fashion shoot and if that stuff's important, you'll want to have the clothes ahead of time. So since we didn't, I said, let's go gray. Worst case scenario, we could gel or whatever, but it wasn't really what I wanted to do. So we ended up sticking with gray, which I actually like. I don't hear an echo. Everyone does still have a free trial. Awesome. Yeah, I definitely would give it a shot. It's definitely something you want to play around with. And I wouldn't just download Capture One and mess around with it for 30 days with the images you have. Because I think the real power of it, although you can do some editing like we're going to do, the real power of it is while you're shooting, to me. So, you know, get it a couple days before you have a shoot and then actually use it tethered. All right, so here we go. We have sound and picture and in the UK. Nice. All right, so again, this is, you know, if somehow he loved this picture, we could always crop it or do whatever, but I was literally just framing up the green shirt, green jacket in front of the gray background. So this is not a keeper. Here, we're trying to get, again, we got him closer, we're trying to see the vibe was. Again, these first shots are really just basic. Just trying to figure out, I was basically setting up the lights. So I've got two lights here. This is actually a octagon, a 3-foot octo with a grid. You can see just that light. And then this right here is a panel. So the two lights together create that, essentially. So you've got one light, two lights, and then three lights. So when somebody says they want something really flat, which would be this, I find this is a little bit much. So usually I like to add a little something, which was basically that. And you can see the difference here if we put all three of them together. You know, this one to the far left here is way too contrasty. They didn't really want that. I like that, but they don't really want that. This one here, to me, is way, way too flat, and also the color is really good, kind of. And then this one over here has got a little more punch to it. I maybe even tweak this one a little bit. We'll see in a second. No, I didn't. That's right out of camera. No, I did a little bit. I tweaked it. Okay, so I brought the whites up to lighten it up a little bit, but I left the mids the same. So this gave us that extra contrast. And let's start here. So let's assume that, you know, in these kind of shots, what I will normally do is, unless the shot is like a bad, like focus, I completely screwed up, whatever. Can you have Capture One and Lightroom on the same computer? Sure, of course. Actually, I have I had a video a while back, which I used to talk about. My old process used to be I would capture on Capture One and then move everything over to Lightroom for editing because I liked the way the Lightroom edited before. But now Capture One's changed a lot, and I actually like editing in there. But yeah. Really? Secret info on rumored iPad version? I do not, but that would be amazing. One of the things I'm going to work on, and I actually made a video about this, so you guys will see it on that I'll put out where I talk about what I'm going to do for next year, but one of the things I'm doing is I'm trying to convert a lot more of my editing to my iPad so that I can just sit on my couch and edit instead of being in front of the computers all day. But that would be amazing. Because I will tell you what, I had the Hasselblad, if you remember for a while, my brain's going. It's been a long day. But I had the Hasselblad for a while, and that actually tethered X1D. It tethered completely to the iPad, and that was amazing. Oh my God, so good. No, I don't know anything. I haven't got any information about Capture One, unfortunately. I probably should have reached out. You know what? If this becomes a thing you guys want to see, let me know. Like the video for sure so I know you guys like it. But let me know, too, if you wanted me to bring these back. Because I was talking with Capture One. They were asking what kind of stuff we could do together. So if people are interested, I'll do these. And then I can maybe get a rep to sit in. Oh, yeah. It's pretty cool. All right. So here we go. All right, so here we are. I'm just going to select everything and hit Command-R because I may have done some tweaking on them when the client was there just to kind of show them like what I might do to them. So before I start in this kind of situation, because I had a client there, I reset everything. That's just Command-R. I selected everything, Command-R. So we're going to look at the first image. We don't want any images of them by themselves, so I don't even want this image really. So I'm just going to make that a 2. All right. So typically we're getting our exposure. That looks dark. All right, that looks like about where we were starting. Yeah, you can see I'm getting the exposure. I'm balancing two lights here, and you can see how I'm going through it. Since, you know, if there was an outstanding shot here, like something that just blew me away, then I would tweak it, but I'd rather start with the right settings from the beginning. So I'm just going to come up to all these first few ones, and we're going to get rid of those. Okay, and then we're going to start here. So this is pretty much where we're at. What I want to do is set myself a baseline, and then we're going to go through these in each one. We're going to add a little bit of tweak to it, and then we're going to move on. If it's a bad picture, it's out of focus, whatever, we're going to get rid of it. That way we can give them a clean edit. So the first thing I like to do, and this is going to be tricky because I'm here, so maybe I will turn myself to do. myself on that side because I was blocked, I was covered before, but you know what? I'd rather have, let me move this. I'd rather have a thing on my face and let you guys see what we're doing than care about that. So I've got a, that's fine. All right. You can do things just like any all photo stuff. You can do things in a number of different ways with Capture One. The tools that I like to use first is this one down here, which is basically levels. People ask me a lot of times why I don't use curves. I do use curves. I do use curves a lot when I'm using Photoshop, but for some reason on Capture One, I like the levels function better. Unless I really have to tweak something, but again, I don't think I'm gonna have to do that here. So what I tend to do is I grab my my brightness side, and I'm gonna bring this over almost brighter than, definitely brighter than I want it to be. And I'm not, when I'm looking at this, I'm looking at the highlights. So I'm looking at like this area of white here, the little reflection in the pearls. Anything that is white or a highlight is what I'm looking at when I'm doing this, right? I'm not worried about everything else, right? And I'm going to move this over till those look correct to me. You know, like for instance, like the shine of the jacket. Once I have it basically right, and oftentimes when you do this, guys, it will make the image look a little brighter than you necessarily want it to be. I mean, unless you like a bright image, I suppose. But once you do that, you'll have your lights kind of where you want them. Then I grab my mid-tones, and this is where I'll set my actual exposure for the skin tone. So I'm going to bring it back a little bit. And then I always like to add a little contrast to make things feel three-dimensional. You will lose detail on things like the hair and stuff when if you pull the dark slider over too far, so you'll be careful about that. But I always pull this over a smidge, and it's I find it useful to always go too far, right, and then come back. Just want to add a little bit of contrast, so you can see it's very, very subtle. Do this. I can get the. There we go. You can see here with this tool, I can see the difference, right? So you look at it, you're probably like, you didn't do anything to that. But if you look at the original image, it was flat, right? Raw images are generally flat, and they wanted flat lighting. So we're looking at what is basically a flat image. We got our before and after. Color-wise, I think it looks pretty good. It looks a little on the cool side for me, so I'm actually going to turn this off for a second. And then I'm gonna jump over to my color balance. And I typically shoot at 5,000 with an Nikon, and that is a little bit cool, you know? So I'm just gonna see if it looks better with a little bit of warmth. Just a smidge, because they both have a warm skin tone. Yeah, I think that's pretty good. Yeah. You don't want to go too far with the white balance because that can sometimes make things look too orange, which doesn't necessarily look good on people's skin if you're doing it to warm them up. But in this case, I'm basically correcting because my, remember, I'm using flash, which is, you know, somewhere around 5,500. So I'm already a little cooler than normal. That looks about right to me based on, you know, me knowing what they look like. Right. So let me know if you have any questions specifically about different tools as we go through them. But this is basically it. Like you can go really crazy far. Like if this was Capture One's a very powerful one. If you want to see stuff about this in future things, I'll shoot some images to be tweaked. That way, this is actually for somebody, so I don't go too crazy. But you can actually go into your individual colors and like tweak them. You got a skin tone. You can actually go to the skin tone picker. You know, we can actually adjust the skin tone itself and stuff like that. So it's pretty cool. You know, it looks around for what is skin tone. What you do is you select a base skin tone, and then you can kind of come in here and adjust it. So you see, it's all very, very subtle. And of course, we can go there as well. I am not going to do that because I don't want that to happen. How do you deal with input from client on the edits? Okay, well, how do I deal with input from the clients? Well, if I'm doing so, this call this editing, I call this tweaking. What I call removing and changing and moving stuff around, what I call retouching. So just so we're using the same terms. You know, the client generally doesn't get involved in this part of it because this is basically color correction and tweaking of contrast. I generally give them an idea though when I'm shooting that of what the final image is going to look like. So like I said, I reset them. I did it really clumsily. It wouldn't have looked this good. Because you know, if I'm going to do too much, but I usually won't do too much. I mean, if I want something to be contrasty, I will shoot it contrasty. But you're always going to want to add a little bit. So insofar as this, I don't really ask. They will, your average person is not going to remember that the image looked a little bit, that the difference here to us when we're looking at it is tremendous. But if they looked at this image like this yesterday, and then they saw it like this today, they really wouldn't notice that much. I mean, they'd notice it looked good, but they wouldn't know, oh, you brighten the highlights. They're not gonna. So I don't ask them about that. Insofar as retouching, though, like for instance, if I was gonna come in and like, let's say I looked at this and I was like, oh, you know what? I really don't like, the way that this her I don't know her finger is here, and I'm gonna change it. I wouldn't do that without talking. No, I didn't generally. Laptop suggestions. I have a MacBook Pro and it works really, really well. I have not used Capture One much on my MacBook Air, but it seemed fine. It really depends more on the size of your files that you're dumping into it. And they do have, thanks, Tara. Yeah, I haven't been editing for a while. I kind of fell off doing Twitch, was where I was doing it, because I wanted to focus more on YouTube. And then I thought to myself, you know what? I can edit on YouTube. So here I am. So yeah, if you guys are interested in this kind of content, let me know because I will continue to do it. All right, so we got the first one set. And again, this is just a tweak. So I'm not going to go too crazy with these. I'm going to more or less, because I get this question a lot too. How do I navigate Capture One? Seems like I don't use a mouse. I have a mouse. I don't know if you can see my mouse. Maybe it's too small for you guys. I'm wagging it around now. Oh, you know what? You might not be able to see the mouse because of how I'm capturing. Oh, I'm using window capture instead of screen capture in OBS, so it's not showing my mouse. Oh, that's kind of aggravating. I don't want to mess with the OBS settings in the middle of the stream, so I think next time I'll go back to doing screen capture. But I watched a video on YouTube that said that you should do window capture, so maybe I won't do that in the future because you can't see my mouse, right? Yeah, you can't see it because I'm waggling there. All right, yeah, sorry guys about that. I will try to save vocally where I'm at. So basically, if you look over in the upper left-hand side, you see there's the histograms and stuff. Right above that is kind of a navigator bar. And right now we're in the one with three circles, which is color. I'm going to go back to the one next to it that has kind of looks like a histogram. That's basically your normal editing. That's where I usually leave it. You can do a lot of funky things in Capture One, but this is 99% of the time where I'm there. Loop deck loss. Is that like Stream Deck? If so, probably. Exactly. General rule of cropping your image as far as cropping off body parts. Whatever looks good is what you should do. People will always tell you that you shouldn't crop this, you shouldn't do that, you shouldn't do whatever, but I think they're just telling you that so that you're more aware of what you're doing. I wouldn't stick with any kind of firm rule on that. Yeah, there can be some weird things where, hey, Scotland, Greg. So I wouldn't worry too much about cropping as long as it looks good to you. I mean, the main reason why you want to be careful about it, especially on the top and the left and the right, is because if they're going to put it somewhere. So for instance, if this was on stark white and their intention was to stick it on a website, like a little like an icon or whatever, I would make sure that I had space all around them. Because if you don't do that, that might look weird. But this is a finished image, so I don't worry too much about like the side of her arm being cut off. I don't want to restrict them too much, and I don't want to restrict myself too much. It's an editing keyboard I am. Maybe. I just use basic stuff. So Command Shift C will copy all my adjustments, and then I'll go down to the next image and I'll just decide. And again, I'm not editing these per se on do I like this image or not, right? I'm editing it based on if it's out of focus, if it's just completely weird, I'll get rid of it. Otherwise, I'm basically this is for the client to see. This is basically for their for them to pick what they want. Okay, I just pasted the thing. So Command Shift Command V is paste. Now, okay, so about cropping. You know, I think I backed up a little bit so I could get more arm here. And then what I got was, because of how close they are to the set, I got the set, right? So if that bothered me and I felt like that didn't look good, I would just come, you can crop as well. So up at top, right above, see, I'm dropping down a thing there. So, oh, you guys can't see that either. That's so weird. Okay. You've got a crop tool. You see that when I do it? No, you don't see any of the tools. Okay. So at the top, I just clicked on the crop tool. I can come in and bring it in. And again, again, people talk about don't crop it at the knees. I mean, I wouldn't crop it right at the knee. That's a little bit weird, but I wouldn't worry too much about it. Whatever looks good. Yeah, there we go. And since they don't have a very specific format they want these in, they're kind of for the web or whatever, so I don't mind about the format. If format mattered, you can actually choose, 8 by 10, whatever, as your top. Oh, there you go. It does. Okay, thank you, Ben. I don't use that kind of stuff. I don't know. I think that they're useful. I did a video about it actually. This company sent me this like editing keyboard thing that you could use, and it had buttons, and I felt, and it was awkward for me. But I guess I'm a mouse person. I mean, I edit in Photoshop with the mouse as well. So I know a lot of people like to use like a tablet, but I do it that way. Okay, if I were to, like, let's say these next few images, I kept that position. So in that case, I'm just going to recopy my settings here because it's now going to pick up the crop as well. So there, right? If I didn't want the crop, but I wanted all the other settings, what I would do is I could come up here, so you can't see, of course, to the there's actually an adjustments. Wow, this is definitely not the way to do it. Okay, sorry about that, guys. There's at the very top of the monitor, there's an adjustment drop-down menu, and when you click on it basically gives you a choice, and you can copy just some of the adjustments or all of them. No, I don't have a tablet at all. I really should use a tablet. I people tell me, I had it early on. I tried a tablet and it just didn't work for me. So, but I'm a different person now. Maybe it would work. All right, so I'm just kind of coming in, and I'm just see now that this crop looks weird, right? I applied the same crop and it looks weird to me. And that's because I'm moving around a little bit. So, I'll just recrop it. So here I'm just going to bring it in on top. The purpose of cropping an image is really to get the people to focus on what you want them to focus on, right? So if you've shot the image in what, because most of us are shooting with some kind of a DSLR or a mirrorless camera at this point, right? So essentially, where you're fixed to that 2:3 or whatever, if you don't set it ahead of time, that's the general size of the camera frame. So, sometimes you're going to want to crop, and when you're doing it, you just want to think about when you crop an image, how does that direct the person viewing it and the composition? So you see, like, there might be too much space on this side of him. So, again, we can come in and take a little bit out of the way. And when I framed it up, it wasn't that big of a deal because there was more space at the bottom. But because I don't want that roll of paper there, I did that. And that makes sense, right? So however you're going to crop really depends on what your partially what your final product is going to be, but also your composition. Like here, right, I wouldn't apply that crop because it would clearly be a problem because they would cut it on their legs too far. So I'm actually going to go to my what I generally do with this is I'll just go up to the last one. There's a couple of different ways you can do it, but you can just go to the last one that you had that wasn't cropped and do it that way, right? Or you can select just the stuff you want. Now this settings does not look, that looks a little soft, so I want to get rid of that one. Remember, I got two people, so by the I get this question a lot too, so I'll talk about it. When you're shooting multiple people, like I tend to try to focus somewhere in the middle of them. So sometimes you're going to end up, if they get too far apart, one person might be slightly out of focus, which we don't really want. Right, the lens itself can also, exactly. On the iPad, interesting. Do you use the iPad like a mouse? Or you just use the iPad, period. Like, not curious about that. Because I'm definitely, like I said, I'm trying to use the iPad more and more as my kind of editing. I'm not a big computer person. Like I never like to sit in front of the computer, which is why I'm not like a real big retoucher. So I'm trying to do as much as possible. I try to do as much as possible, I should say, on the shoot, but sometimes you've got to do, you know, some basic editing. So it'd be nice to be able to do stuff more remotely. You know, remotely being like, all right, so I like this is the same crop, so I'm going to come up here and select this. Go. And again, I'm just pasting the settings. You know, and again, because like that one I don't really like. If there's one that I just don't want, an important thing to know, by the way, and this is kind of not really the best pose in the world because the way she's turned. An important thing to know is that if you ever do anything, like if you ever give a client a picture, no matter how bad you think it is, like you're like, I'll just give this one because it's funny or it's weird or whatever, they might use it. So if you do something in an image and you're just like, oh, you know what, I really didn't like how that came out. Okay, this setting doesn't really work for that photo. So I'm gonna go back. I think it's just too contrasty. So I'm gonna start again. I'm gonna come over here to my levels. So again, I'm on the left-hand side. You can see I'm moving that level till I get it where I want it. I'm gonna move the neutral back. And I think in this case, she's getting more light on her from the softbox, which has got which is not picking up the room light as much, so her color looks better too. So I'm gonna come in, and I am still gonna tweak it, but probably not nearly as much. So I've got this. Boom. 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 And see, guys, when I came to this one, I didn't like it. But you see, it's orange. Oh, you can't see because it's blocked. This one is orange. So, like, it's one of the ones they liked. So, this is why when they select something on the spot, you definitely want to keep track of it because I would have edited that out. That's just a funny thing because that happens to me a lot. And again, in this case, because it's a collaboration, it's for their use or whatever. It's not some personal art project of mine. They like something, I'm gonna give it to them unless it's really, if it was out of focus or something, I wouldn't. If it's just not my favorite thing in the world. Again, I'm just pasting the same settings. Move too fast there, okay. The whole concept here is this kind of like very entwined and like mixed vibe. Okay. Issue like this. Yeah, so I mean, what I would normally do, it depends. A lot of times, what I'll do is just select a bunch of them and just paste the settings on all of them and then go down, but I'm going one by one because I'm talking to you guys. So, like, what I probably would do, I guess I should show you the way I would do it, is these are all the same, right? So, what I can do is grab this. You can do this in Lightroom as well. I've grabbed the top one, and I can just come down and I'll just scroll until I get to the place where it looks like the light may have changed, which I think it really did for any of these. Looks a little bit brighter on those, but I think that's pretty good. It basically was the same. This is a pretty tame shoot as far as the lighting. Okay, so it changes there. Okay, so all the ways to here, it's pretty much the same. So if I do this and I just paste, I'll drop the settings on all of them at once. So that's probably a faster way to do it, and then you don't have to keep command clicking. But I don't know, it depends on my mood, but that's usually how I would do it. Yeah, I would edit the first shot of the series, of the sequence, I should say. And then I would come back and go through them just as an edit, right? So like I'm going through this. And let's say, okay, I don't like that, or I do like that, or whatever, you know, and I can kind of make a decision here. Like right there, I think her eyes are a little bit weird, so I'm gonna go. I kind of caught her in a half blink. So at this point, I'm literally just going through them, and just if they're like out of focus or something is particularly weird, gonna, and again, there can be cropping and stuff to these later. I'm not cropping them for a final edit. I'm just giving them the images that. Yeah, I thought that too. So if you look at this, it looks like I want to change the light a little bit. See how much these others are brighter? I was looking at the other ones going, they are a little bit dark to me. So I was considering making another tweak, and it looks like I should. So I'm going to look down at this one, which is what I adjusted it to in camera, and I'm going to come back here, and I'm going to make this one equal that. Because I actually, yeah, definitely. Daniel likes it bright. All right, and again, I'll just copy. And then what I'll do is I'll just go like this, and I'll go all the ways back up. One thing you want to do for sure when you're delivering to a client, in my opinion, is that you want to make sure it's consistent. You know, I don't want to edit these pictures and then have them. This is one reason why I copy and paste and I don't do them individually, is because I want to make sure that when they go from one image to another, they look the same. Like not one slightly darker or brighter than the other. So it's easier just to apply the same settings. Here's a weird crop on his finger, and I remember actually doing it and then going, oh, hold on, we got to re. That, but I will keep it anyways because I think that he actually liked this one, although he didn't check it out. Yeah, like there's some weird stooping here, but I know that they were thinking about doing some pretty tight crops on some of these, you know. So if they do like this, that might work, like almost as a square, right? Because currently, as it is, I'm not really a huge fan, because the way that she's stooped down, but you see, as a square, it works. Coming to mobile, that's really cool. Okay, you do the editing and on the light. Yeah, see, I would totally do that as well. Well, that's cool. Masks? For fine adjustments, yeah, I'm not doing any fine adjustments. Use a 23-inch touchscreen with a mini PC mounted on the back. Acts like a large tablet. Oh, that's pretty cool. Z7? This is actually a Z6 too. Yes. That kind definitely has a their color is definitely more green than Canon's, that is very red. All right, yeah, all these are fine. Nothing super exciting here, which is good. That's what you want, right? You want consistency. If there's anything that, again, that point that I see that's really weird, I'll come in and drop it. And again, because it wasn't really my 100% idea, there, I think too much of the hand is cut off, so I'm gonna get rid. Because it wasn't 100% my idea as far as what we were doing, I'm not going to be too judgmental. Like something happened here. Like possibly I overshot and one of the flashes didn't go off. Because, yeah, there's like a weird shadow. So I'm going to come in actually. Actually, I think what happens is I'm just giving it more space now. I actually kind of like these better as square. So. That question that you asked about, do you ask them? In this case, no. I mean, I just think it looks better as a square. So again, I can definitely come in here and make this a square, and then I can come over here and bang. Right, and we're good to go. Will it be recorded? Yeah, it should stay on YouTube. So if you come back later, it should be here, unless I did something wrong. Hope so. Oh, I don't know what just happened here. I lost my chat. There we go. All right, let's see. Oh, now you're small again. Can I make this chat pop up? Show your support. Create a poll. Custom. Why did I do that? Pop out chat. That's what I want. There we go. Got it. All right, now the chat's nice and big. Oh, no, it's not big. Why is it so small? There we go. Okay, well, the chat popped out, but it's really small, so. Can this be done also while you're tethering? Yeah, 100%. So when you're shooting tethered, I wish you could see my mouse. But I will try to explain it a little bit. When you're shooting, so when you come over to the left-hand side of the screen, And the upper part where the menus are, you see up the very top is like a little camera. I'm going to click on that now. And we can see I don't have a camera connected, of course, but over here is the camera section. And what you can do is when you come over here to Next Capture Naming, which is opened up there, below that, you got location, then you also have adjustments. And then what I have clicked on, where the let's see, the fourth one, it says copy from last. You can also set it to copy from primary, so you could set one, right? Copy from clipboard, whatever, that kind of stuff. So what that means is, essentially, if I was tethered and I shot this image, this one here that's on the screen, and then I went and took another image, it would keep all those adjustments. That's kind of the beauty of shooting tethered, is you can then have your images pop in with the quick adjustments on them. And remember, they're raw, so it's not like the adjustment's permanent. You can always tweak it later, but you can have it come in, especially if you've got something like a layout that you want to, stick to. Like, let's say we knew this was going to be square, and they kept looking at it rectangular and being like, oh, I don't like the way my kneecaps look. But it's like, your kneecaps aren't going to be in the shot because it's square. They would just pop in that way. Like, I focused on the wrong person there. Yeah, there we go. Weird eye. Boom. And again, I'm just pasting. The other thing I do, by the way, guys, when you're editing pictures, is you don't want to spend too long. This is why I don't do a deep dive right away. You don't want to spend too long on any one picture because most people are going to look at pictures for like a second, before they move on or like it or not like it, right? So what you want to do with your pictures is when you're doing your initial edit, you want to look at them very quickly because that's how people are going to see them. If it doesn't grab you immediately, if you have to look around and be like, maybe, then it's probably not a very good picture. So that's a good idea. And this is another reason why I do it this way, because if in the end, like you said, and believe me, this has happened to me. If in the end I'm like, no, and then I look and like I don't have any pictures left, then I just go back and start over. But hopefully you realize that while the client's still there and you can shoot more. Let's see. Where are we at? Oh yeah, I'm totally on messes. It's fun. Just as I went live, I didn't realize it was coming up. I mean, she did tell me, but then I totally slipped my mind. You should go over to Vanessa Joy's channel after this. Because she's got a actually I'll try to put the link. We did a challenge with the OG 5D. Man, that was a fun little thing. Not many Canon deals this year. I would use Capture One if it was available for Lumix. Save the settings. Or the imported, so it keeps changes every image. Yep. Yeah, exactly. So you can do instant tethered black and white. You can apply settings on it. You can do whatever you do, and you can actually save them. Yeah. Recently picked up a Fuji GFX. Seems overrated. You're getting better from your Sony. Well, I mean, how long were you using the Sony for? No camera is going to be perfect out of the box. You've got to figure out what works for you with it. So, I mean, I like the Fujis a lot. I've never been a huge fan of the color that Sony puts out, but if you like that color, it makes sense that you probably don't like the Fuji color because it's much different, right? But I would give it a chance. I don't know, overrated. It's certainly not a, it's a different beast. I mean, if you're using a big, chunky, relatively slow, medium format-ish camera versus a small, agile, mirrorless camera, you're going to shoot differently, and the images are going to be different. I wouldn't expect the image quality to be so much better right off the bat, but I think the Fuji makes pretty good cameras. I think that's the one that I used. It was pretty good. I mean, yeah, I like Fuji. What about getting cast from the clothing? Is there anything you can do about it? Or it is what it is? That's a good question. I don't worry about getting color cast from the clothing on skin tone per se, unless there it's like a beauty shot and I was really worried about it. Because where you're mostly going to see the color cast is number one, if there's a lot of it, and if there's a lot of the color, like let's say somebody I mean, you're saying clothing, but let's say that they're near like draperies that are red or something, and they're real close to it and they get some red on their face. That's going to look natural on the shot. So I wouldn't overly worry about that. If because they're smushed together, you're saying, if they're going to pick up color from the clothes, if it looks natural, I wouldn't worry too much about it. You can actually go in there and tweak the skin tone as noted. Let's see if I can do it. Again, this is something I so rarely do. See, the focus is on the wrong person here. You can, even at F8, you're really only focusing on one person. Let's drop that. There we go. All right, so let's say we're taking this image and we're looking at the skin tone here. If we go over to, I know you can't see my mouse, but I'm going to go over to the left-hand side. There's a setup here with three dots, which I'm going to click on. You should see the thing change at the top. And then you've got the skin tone. I never do this, so this will be fun. You got the skin tone editor. And what you can do is you come down, you grab this little dropper. So I just clicked on the dropper. And then you select the color that is skin tone. So let's say, for instance, we think that her skin tone is being contaminated. It'd be more likely to be his. Let's say his skin tone is being contaminated. I'm going to click on it. And then what I can actually do is within the skin tone, I can actually move around the color and adjust his skin tone. And it's pretty subtle because it's basically selecting the colors around that color as the base skin tone. So it's not going to mess with all the color. And you can actually spread it out too if you want a wider range of colors to be grabbed. You can, you know, spread it out like that. I mean, obviously most people's skin tone is not going to be over in the green section, you know, unless you're, you know, Turtle Hulk or something. So, you know, they're generally going to end up over here in the more warm colors. And what you'll do is you'll basically take your skin tone and you can then adjust it. You know, you've got your conformity. You can see that. There we go. I'm making a huge adjustment so you can see it. So we can actually see, like, I'll move it all the way there. See how we made it like really, really on the pinky side, right? Versus over here, we're really, really on the green side. So you definitely can, of course, you can adjust saturation, and we can also adjust the lightness, darkness thing. So we can make it look really like somebody did a really bad, terrible Photoshop job on it, right? And of course, you can also collect select very selective colors. So you can pretty much go crazy with this. I would recommend being careful about this, unless it's really a factor, right? If you find yourself in a situation where the skin tone was very, very affected, then I might mess around with this a lot. But generally speaking, I'm gonna probably keep things more or less where they are, you know, because I want my images to look natural. And if I'm careful when I'm shooting, you really shouldn't have too much problem with contamination. It can happen, but it shouldn't be too big of a deal. So hopefully that was helpful. I can actually, if people are interested in specifically in the skin tone thing, I can actually shoot something that would be more applicable. This isn't that applicable of a shot to see how you would do that, but if you're interested in that, I'll go out and shoot an image or two that might be effective. Let me know, like, you know, either in the chat here or in the comments would be even better after the video is done. What it is about Capture One you're curious about, and I can try to make some specific content about that. Okay, so I'm going back to the histogrammy adjustment area here. Only picked up food. Okay. Icon released NX Tether. No, I haven't tried that. You know, Nikon had tethering software before. I wasn't overly impressed. I've been using Capture One since before you could really use it with DSLRs. So, I mean, I just don't have any need or desire to change to Nikon specific software. The only reason why I might want to do it is possibly it might give me a different RAW file I might like better because, you know, Nikon's way of working the algorithms or whatever. But I'm not, I know, I haven't tried, nor will I, unless Nikon sends me some free copy to try because I'm certainly not going to pay for it. Or is it free? Oh, it is free. Maybe I'll try it. He's just like, oh, thank you. Oh, hey, that's for Cal. Yes, they are. Hey. Yeah. Killing the house. The ones who don't know, that's the model of, I just say at the beginning. Probably. I'm terrible at shouting out people. Yes. Oh, Lupe. Nice. I'm wondering if you might know, there's been pretty far away people here. Who here is the furthest away is the question. Anybody from Australia? That'd probably be about as far as we. So back to this. This is again a new setup, so I'm going to go in here and look at my settings and see what I might may or may not want to change. I just look at the first image, unless I change the lighting, which it doesn't look like I really did. Nope. So gonna come in, and I always do the same thing just to kind of see how it works out. Whether or not we'll have to adjust the lights. I always try because I'm looking to get those highlights to pop. Because you think about paintings, for instance, and how they get a two-dimensional image to look three-dimensional is they do it through highlight and shadow. So we I think people are often afraid of blowing out highlights. I mean, that's like early digital fear where it's like highlights blow out. But we're in a RAW file and I can always bring them back. So like I always come in and I always push my highlights to where the max, even though at this point it looks like the image is getting too light, because then we're going to grab our mids and bring them back. Because our mids are really where our skin tone generally is. There are obviously images you might shoot where the person's skin tone will not be the mid tone of the shot. Whether they, it could be if they're very, very particularly dark or light skin, but also just because of the way you shoot it. But in this case, their skin tone is basically the mid tone. So I'm adjusting that. And I'm bringing my darks in a little bit to give that contrast. She's out giving contrast around, showing off her cheekbone nicely and also under her chin. Just a little bit of dark, not too much. And once we've got that figured out, again, I'll jump back over to the color because I think I wanted them to be a little bit warmer, which is what we've had. Not too much, though, because again, if you add too much warmth this way, you start to make people look like they are orange. You don't want people to look orange. You can also use the three-way color wheel to do this. So again, their skin tone is the mid-tone. So I could theoretically grab this and adjust the skin tone by moving this around if I so desired. Not going to, but you can do that. So there's lots of ways to do things, obviously. That looks pretty good to me. I'm now going to Shift Command C to copy all the adjustments, and I'll move in. This is just a we're sitting in for the light, so you get the solo shot. Do you mean? Cool, and we're back. You see how that adds that contrast? It might actually be a little bit. Now I'm looking at it, it may actually be a little bit too dark. That looks about right. It's always good to. Again, you probably see when I do this, I always do this really quickly because again, you want to just go with your gut with this. Like you don't want to stare at things too long. It won't make it any better. You want to, boom. You either like it or you don't. It's either composed right or it's not, and it's either the right color or it's not. And your gut will tell you. So that looks perfect to me. So I'm going to copy these settings, and then we'll start to move down and just paste them. And if we find anything that we need to mess with, we'll do that as we go. Again, if there's any that are out of focus, or there's a blink or something, we'll take it out. Otherwise, there's Cotter looking at the computer screen, but leave that there for guilt. Oh, he's talking. Oh. All right. Cool. Yeah, these look good. All right. Down. At the talker, we'll get rid of that. Cool. Again, just pasting the. Oh. Just pasting the settings because they look good. Not being overly critical about anything unless it's a technical problem at this point because the subjects are going to be looking at all of them so they can pick what they like. You will occasionally encounter people that don't want you to do that. They're just like, pick one for me, and that's also fine. But usually in my first edit, I'm really just going with my gut. And again, you could just, instead of doing each one at a time, I could just go down through this entire session. Oh, there's the last one. Oh no, there's the last one. Of this lighting and then just paste on all of them. But even if you do that, you still want to go back to the top and run through them just to make sure that there's not like a blank or out of focus or something like that that you get rid of. The worst thing is to like deliver an image and they're like, this is the best one. And then, when they're looking on their phone and then they blow it up and it's out of focus. All right, I think this lighting's the same. Yeah, it is. Okay, so I just pasted the same settings and it looked good. So I think we're good here. The other thing I was figuring out composition. Shoes. It was the gotta make sure we get the shoes in the shot. It's all about the shoes. So again, I'm just rolling down. These are all lit the same. So I'm just rolling down. Oh, sure, I love these. Okay. Rolling down to here, selecting all of them. I'm just going to paste those settings. And it's pretty minor, so, but still, little bits make a difference. In an ideal world, you want to shoot your images as close to final as possible so that when you do this comparison, right, it's pretty close. All we really did was add that little punch of contrast and clean the color up a little bit, right? Like that. New Jersey, that's not so far away. It's closest to me. Australia, yes! Hold on. So I have a question about Australia. Get ready for it. So I'm internet friends with in a gaming group with somebody from Australia, and they made a post about their children were about to go on summer break, and I guess it's summer in Australia, which I guess I knew that, but it was just strange to me because I was thinking, well, it's also like Christmas and New Year's and all these other holidays. I always think of as like cold holidays, but I guess that's because I'm from the northeast of the United States. But it's just interesting to me to think of it being on summer break. So what's that like? Okay, New Jersey. Oh man, Southwestern. You can swim to Antarctica. Oh man. It's so funny. For some reason earlier, my friend was like, you know that off the coast of Argentina, they have icebergs. And I was like, what? Because you forget, how close to Antarctica those places are. But it's same thing with Australia. Endo, Florida. Your friend got bitten by a penguin. Don't swim into penguin territories. Hold on. Were they like the little tiny ones or like the big ones? Aren't they like little penguins and the big penguins? Or do I know nothing about penguins and I'm speaking foolishly? All right. So here's a chair creaks. Here's another thing, right? We've got this situation where I got the edge of the paper in here. You can deal with this a lot of different ways. I mean, the simplest thing to do, obviously, is to crop it. But let's say that we wanted this to be, and I wouldn't do this in a basic tweak, but if we didn't want to crop it, for whatever reason, although I would just crop this one, I guess, that's the kind of thing where you might like fill in. When things aren't crossing the subject, that's when I would like use editing to fill it in, use like the stamp tool or whatever. Sometimes people ask about that. Like, which, if it was like through their legs, I probably would crop it unless it didn't look good. Because that's a whole lot of editing for a whole lot of nothing. Oh, a lot of focus again. Sometimes I press the button too quickly. Is my light in the shot? It's okay. Having the light in the shot is always cool, you know? Boy, I was motoring. Sometimes I'm. Just letting them go at it and just kind of do their thing. Also, while we get one that's soft, I'm just looking for those soft ones. And also, those pants are amazing. I say it then, I'll say it again. Yeah, summer break is Christmas time. It's too hot to get used to adjust to it. I can imagine, right? Like how crazy for me to. But then again, I think I lived in on South Beach in Miami Beach for many years, and I gotta say that, yeah, I guess you get used to it. But it's just interesting to me to think of that's when the break is. At the bottom here, we got creeping in. All right, so I'm just gonna. We got a little cat ears coming in. We'll crop this off. Boom. The other thing is, when you shoot like this and it's really clean, a lot of these are going to be very usable just the way they are, with nothing done to them. When you tweak them at all. So if there is something where I want to crop it, I'm doing it now. Even though I say that I'm not doing anything to them, the reason why I crop it is so that. Apparently, I was crooked here. I think I was just checking the light. So I'm just going to come in and crop this. You don't see outside the frame. Doesn't hurt you. Influences, musicians. Alberta, Canada. Northwest Alberta. That is too chilly for me. This moment. See, unfortunately, like we have this green tape here, which we eventually move. That's something that would need to be dealt with the layers. Unfortunately, since you can't see my mouse, I don't want to do too much editing because you're not going to be able to see what I'm doing. But effectively, there's a layers tool, and you can kind of come in here and you can either use a healing mask or a clone mask, and you just kind of paint over. Ooh. A source here. So it's like, you option click. And we just kind of paint it in. I don't know if you can even see that. Oh, I guess you can see the red. You can't see my mouse. I just did it really quickly, but so clearly it's not perfect. But what I normally do for something big like this is I would clone it out first, and then I would come back in and do a the healing around the edges. That's usually the To me, anyways, seems to be the best way to handle this. Because if you just try to heal it, sometimes you get, it's a little imperfect. So, kind of do that. Just go. See, the green came back because I was healing it. So that's how you basically handle that. But it's not worth really showing you because I can't show you my mouse, so you can't really see what I'm doing. So it's. It's a whole lot of nothing happening, magic happening that you can't see. Someone's gonna crop it. All right, there we go. Oh, and by the way, guys, if you were to want to, gotta leave. Bye. All right, see you. Yeah, I probably should hang out here anyways. I think I said I was gonna do this for an hour, and it's already been. All right, so, all right, we got these. Let's see, we got the. Looks good. Come in here. I'm not going to worry too much about. Again, I'm just pasting those same settings. It looks like they work here too. I mean, the lighting hasn't really changed, so we'll just go down. I think the whole rest of this is the same setup, so I'm just going to select the rest of them. We'll paste the settings. And we'll come back up. And we'll just kind of work our way through them, checking if anything looks weird. Blanks, out of focus, anything like that. Sometimes capture one takes a second if I'm going too fast. I will leave the cat ones because I think they're fun. Where the cat's kind of walking through. We eventually do get. And of course, being terrible with names, I've totally forgot the name of the cat. But What a beautiful like a tiger. Cool. These look good. Double lean. Good, good, good. And we're down at the bottom. So now we've ended up with right, exactly. Nice like button. Thank you. All right, so now I'm gonna select everything again now that I've reached this stage, and I'm gonna actually mark them all 4 stars. So the next step to this is I do 3 stars, then everything I didn't get rid of down to 2, I make 4, and then I come back to the top. I guess you could go backwards if you want to, but I go back to the top, and then I go here and I search 4 stars or better. And then I'll do, typically at this point, I would do a second round of edits. But like I said, in this case, it's because they're going to want to. I didn't apply any kind of a. Oh, there we go. In this case, because they kind of want to see them all, I'm just going to just give them all the 4-star ones. But if I was then going to go down and edit them for myself, you know, decide what I wanted, I would go through and let's say I was like, don't love that one. I'd hit 3 on that. Because that way I kind of know where things are, right? I'm not like doing double the work. At some point I can go back and look at my 3s. And actually sometimes I'll pull out a shoot from like a year ago and I'll look at just the 3s, you know, to see what I didn't like at that point that I might like now, because that happens. All right, so kind of the final step here is we'll select them all. And there's a whole bunch of them here. And then I've got like that one. That was for so I select everything and I'm going to go over here to the upper left hand side again. I'll do this differently next time so you can see my mouse properly. And I've got a process recipe set up over here in the corner. Now, there's a few that I use. I mean, you can also just make one up as you go, but essentially, I have this one called Model Dropbox that I've selected. And what that does is I have some settings down here, 2000 pixels long, and it does it actually puts it in my Dropbox and it creates a folder named for the shoot. So since I've already named the folder the model's name and the date that we shot, when I do this, effectively, once it's all exported to Dropbox, I can just share it with them and I know what I've got going on. So I'll hit that and I would hit process. I don't know how long this is going to take, so I'm going to wait to do that because I don't want to. I have done this before and it's made the computer go crazy because it starts really processing to crank out 200 pictures. But let me just quickly check over here in the chat, see if there's anything I need to. Hopefully, I didn't miss anything, guys. I think I'm going to let you go now, though, because I went a little longer than I planned, but not that much longer, though, since I started late. Sorry about the late start, everyone. We had some kind of weird internet thing where it was only throwing out 700 kilobytes. Now I was like, if I go live with that, it's going to be a mess. So I restarted everything. But if you have not already, if you've made it this far, subscribe to the channel, please ring the bell. Let me know in the comments below, or I guess in the chat if you do it really quickly. What else you want me to see? I can definitely do more stuff with Capture One. Like I said, they did reach out to me, you know, to say and said, "Hey, you want to do something with us?" But I wasn't doing those editings anymore, so I kind of stepped back from it. But if you like this kind of stuff and you want to see me do more, I can maybe get a Capture One rep into the chat, maybe, and they could answer like some of the more technical questions that are just the things that I don't use because there's so much you can do here with Capture One. And if I don't go live again before then. Have a wonderful New Year's and Christmas holiday if you celebrate those things. And if you don't, well, then have an incredible next 2 weeks, I guess. And I will see you next time.